We have seen that how nodulation occurs, and now we will be seeing regarding the nitrogen fixation process happening, and with the help of the nitrogenase enzyme. And you should know that nitrogenase and enzyme complex is basically consisting of two portions. It has got an Fe protein and a molybdenum iron protein, and it receives the reducing power from the ferredoxin, and utilizing 16 ATP, this initial portion, Fe protein gets activated, and finally the electrons are passed to the MoFe protein, and finally will result in the reduction of the nitrogen to ammonia. And the ferredoxin, basically ferredoxin is reducing the first portion, that is the Fe protein portion of the enzyme. Binding and hydrolysis of ATP to the Fe protein is thought to cause a conformational change of the Fe protein that facilitates the redox reaction. So the binding of the ATP, binding and hydrolysis of the ATP to the Fe protein, that the first portion of the nitrogenase, is thought to cause a conformational change. A change is being occurring in this Fe protein part that facilitates the redox reactions, which is going to happen in the next stage. The Fe protein reduces the MoFe protein portion, that is the second portion of the nitrogenase enzyme, and the MoFe protein reduces the nitrogen to ammonia. The nitrogenase enzyme complex can be separated into two components. We have already seen the Fe protein and the MoFe protein. And the first portion, that is Fe protein, is the smaller of the two components and has two identical subunits of 30 to 72 kilodalton each, depending on the organism. So it may vary from organism to organism. And each subunit contains an iron sulfur cluster, that is a cluster of 4 iron and 4 sulfur, and they participate in the redox reactions involved in the conversion of nitrogen to ammonia. The Fe protein is irreversibly inactivated by oxygen with typical half decay times of 30 to 45 seconds. So this is the portion, that is the first portion of the nitrogenase, is more sensitive towards oxygen, and that gets irreversibly damaged, inactivated by the presence of oxygen, and with a typical half decay times of 30 to 45 seconds. Within that short span of time, it is totally inactivated. The MoFe protein has 4 subunits with a total molecular mass of 180 to 235 kilodalton. And again, that variation is there, is depending upon the species to species. Some species it may be 180, or it may be sometimes 235, or in between also. Each subunit has 2 MoFeS clusters, that is molybdenum, iron and sulfur clusters. The MoFe protein is also inactivated by oxygen. So not only the first portion, but this also is activated. But here the half decay time in air is of 10 minutes. Comparatively, that has a longer half decay time. So if you compare these two, the most vulnerable would be the first portion Fe protein, and there you have already seen that it is only 30 to 45 seconds for the half decay time and in the presence of oxygen, but here it is 10 minutes for the half decay time. Now, because the ammonia is synthesized by the action of the nitrogenase, and now you should also know that amides and urids are the transported forms of nitrogen, and it is synthesized in the root nodules. But this same ammonia has to be taken to different parts of the plant, maybe to the leaves of the plants. And normally it cannot be taken in the ammonia, because initially you have already seen that ammonia itself is dangerous, especially it can hamper with the proton gradient of a cell, and we saw the significance of that. So therefore, the ammonia itself cannot be transported, and it may not be transported as an amino acid also, because whenever the plant always tries to transport it in a high carbon to nitrogen ratio. You already seen that in the asparagin it was 4:2, and in the case of glutamine it was 5:2. 4 means it was for carbon, and 2 was for nitrogen. For 4 carbon, for every 4 carbon, there was 2 nitrogen going along with the asparagine. And in the case of glutamine, for every 5 carbon, there was 2 nitrogen going. So the ratio was 4:2 for asparagine, 5:2 for glutamine. So generally, these two forms of amides and urids are the transported forms of nitrogen. The symbiotic nitrogen fixing prokaryotes release ammonia, and to avoid a toxicity must be rapidly converted into organic forms. Again, I want to repeat, the ammonia which is released by the nitrogen fixation process will not remain in the form of ammonia immediately, because being toxic, immediately it will be converted into an organic form in the root nodules before being transported to the shoot via xylem. And nitrogen fixing legumes can be divided into amide exporters or urid exporters on the basis of the composition of the xylem sap. Amide forms already we have seen, it may be the asparagine and the glutamine, and urids will be seeing later. Amides, the principally the amino acids, asparagine or glutamine are exported by temperate region legumes. So mainly the amide forms are preferred in the temperate region legumes, such as in the case of pea, pisum, clover, trifolium, broad bean, visia, and lentil, lens. So these are the generic names. Side by side I was trying to mention the generic names also. Again I repeat, in the case of pea, in the case of clover, broad bean and lentil, the preferred form of transportation of ammonia is in the form of amides, and urids are generally exported by legumes of tropical origin. Tropical means that is our condition here, it is a tropical condition here, such as in the case of soybean, kidney bean, that is fasciolus, peanut, arachis, and southern pea, that is vigna. In all these tropical legumes, they are generally transported in the form of urids. And the major three forms of urids are allantoin, allantoic acid, and citrulline. So try to remember this. The two major forms of amides we have already seen, that is glutamine and asparagine. And urids, the major ones are, three major urids are allantoin, allantoic acid, and citrulline. Allantoin is synthesized in peroxisomes from uric acid, and allantoic acid is synthesized from allantoin in the endoplasmic reticulum. And the site of citrulline synthesis from amino acid ornithine has not been determined, but studies are being carried out on where exactly the site of citrulline synthesis are being done. The studies are being going on this particular aspect. Now, if you try to conclude with this particular area of nitrogen fixation, you will be also interested to knowing what are the factors affecting the rate of nitrogen fixation. Because once we know about the factors affecting the rate of nitrogen fixation, we can try to manipulate in that area and try to enhance the nitrogen fixation ability or capacity of the plants. And people are working in this direction also. One of the direction in which people are working is to attempt to increase the efficiency of nodulation by altering genes in rhizobia and by selecting more compatible host varieties. So now you know that there is high host specificity for the rhizobia. So only a specific strain of rhizobia will come and bind to a host. Imagine a situation wherein you can try to bring about more association of rhizobia to the host. That means you can enhance the nodulation capacity of the legumes. And for that, how can you manipulate? You can manipulate the node genes so that specific node factors are synthesized, which will bind to the lectins present on the legumes, and the specificity can be reduced. And since the specificity can be reduced, the more type of bacteria can come and invade or colonize in the legumes, and more nodulation takes place. More nodulation means more nitrogen fixation. So one of the research area, if you are interested in this area to work on, it would be to work with the genes, especially the node genes, try to manipulate them, try to achieve more, reduce the specificity of the bacteria to attach with the host, so that the more bacteria can colonize, form nodules, and that way the nitrogen fixation capacity of the plants can be increased. And second area where you can work upon is on nitrogenase. Nitrogenase have a higher H plus, because more than nitrogen it prefers the combining with H plus, and that is one of the drawbacks of the nitrogenase enzyme. And if you can try to reduce the H plus competition with nitrogen, so the nitrogen should be in a better position to combine with nitrogenase and convert into ammonia, and not the H plus, that is the protons or the hydrogen ions. So that would be one of the other area where you can work on. And still another area could be to lower the inhibitory effect of oxygen on the nitrogenase. That is again another area to be worked upon, because now we know that nitrogenase has got a high inhibitory effect because of the presence of oxygen. So if you can try to work on that, then that means you are can permit more of oxygen into the tissues, and that means the even the nodulating tissues can have a better respiratory rate, better NADH production and all. So there will not be any oxygen limitation for that, even if more oxygen is permitted. But that oxygen in no way inhibit the nitrogenase also. So that is another area which you can try to work upon and try to increase the efficiency of nitrogen fixation in plants. So with this topic, we can come to a conclusion on the nitrogen metabolism of plants. So just to make a concluded remarks on this topic, we have already seen with regarding to how the nodulation occurs, the genes involved in this process, and how the genes determine the specificity to the host. Based on that, how the particular rhizobium will come and attached or get associated with the plant, and how the bacteria enters into the plant, how the infection thread is formed, and how the nodulation occurs. And once the nodulation is formed, the nitrogenase activity get initiated, and how nitrogenase activity will culminate in the conversion of nitrogen to ammonia. And after the formation of ammonia, how the ammonia is immediately taken care by combining it with another amino acids for the formation of amides and urids. The prominent amides you have already seen, they are the asparagine and glutamine. And the urid form also you have seen, that is allantoin, citrulline, these are the urid forms. And this amide forms and urid forms, the amide forms are more preferred in the case of temperate plants, and the citrulline, the other urid forms are more preferred in the case of tropical legume plants. And once they are synthesized in the roots, they are being transferred or transported to other parts of the plant in this amide or urid forms, and they are further utilized. Once they reach the area of their utilization, the ammonia is being transferred to the necessary structures, chemical structures. So with this, we conclude the nitrogen metabolism part.